Thank you for your stewardship and tithes and offerings, and looking forward to sharing God's word with you. Turn your Bible to the book of Hebrews. Children, you be dismissed for children's church. At this time, others turn in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews. Thank you to the children's workers. You are loved. Amen. Amen. Give them a hand. That's exactly right. Yes. Give them a hand and prayers. Appreciate the good work that they do. And Patty is always wanting to recruit and looking for new children's workers, and we'll plug you in there and get you some help any way we can, but we'd love to have some more children's workers. Well, it has been really going on 2 weeks for the staff here. Your staff at this church has worked very diligent the last 2 weeks leading up to Easter and in this week. And next week we'll take some good time off and rest in the Lord. So you need to pray for your staff and appreciate the wonderful staff at this church. In losing Josh Lumpkin, him and Katie were married a little over 4 months. I think this all happened Easter evening when he had that major bleed from the stem of his neck or from the stem back. I don't want to get it wrong, so I won't say too much, but the major brain bleed there, and everything went downhill from there. 32 years old. We are flesh. Solomon said we come up and are cut down like a flower. We never continue in one stay. We are flesh. We have a soul. The soul of man never dies. Make sure you are right with the Lord, because you never know when you may not have another Sunday to worship, to get right, whatever it is. Make sure you're right with the Lord. 32 years old. Wonderful young man. Everything that you pray for that precious, precious family. So I wanted to preach on heaven. I need to preach on heaven. How many of you would say, Pastor, I have loved ones in heaven today? Yeah. Yeah, most of us would say, yes, Pastor, I've got loved ones that are in heaven today. Some of them would be very, very close to you. Let's stand together for the reading of God's holy word. The book of Hebrews, chapter 11, is where we're going to begin. I want to preach a message I've entitled, Heaven's My Home. Heaven is my home. Christian, this is not your home. You're a pilgrim passing through, the Bible says. Christian, you and I are strangers in this weary land. That's what the Bible teaches. Don't grow too attached. Appreciate and admire, but don't fall in love with the world or the things of the world. Because the Bible says that if you do, the love of the Father's not in you. So hold the things of the world very lightly. I taught my girls growing up, things are things. They're just things. Somebody said a long time, I will not cry for things that cannot cry for me. Well, Hebrews chapter 11 teaches as much. Verse 1, it says, now faith is, right now, presently, faith is the substance of things hoped for, okay? It's what you're hoping for, and faith begins with hope. I hope this takes place. I hope this person gets saved. I hope God heals. I hope God delivers. I hope this takes place. I hope he meets my need there or has this take place. It's the evidence of things not seen. I don't have it yet. I don't touch it yet. It's not in my hand yet. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. There was nothing, and God said, let there be something, and it was happened. By faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaketh, he'll always be remembered by his gifts. by his faith what he did. Verse 5, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony. He pleased God. But without faith, it's impossible to please him. Verse 6 again, without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is. And he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, and reigned, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world, and he became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Look at verse 13 now. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out here, they might have had opportunity to have returned. There's a pullback. This world wants to pull us back into it. But now they desire a better country. That is a heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. And I'm going to ask you to believe some things, to think some things, and to have some faith on some things that I share this morning. Pray with me. Jesus, thank you for the precious word of God. Thank you that I get to preach it. It's the privilege of my life. I thank you, Jesus. And I understand the awesome responsibility. I pray that you would give us ears to hear, a heart that is very open to your Holy Spirit and receptive, and a heart that's able to discern what's Billy and what's Bible. Help us always, Lord, to be discerning. Where I get in the way, forgive me. And Jesus, I pray that our lives would be based upon your precious word of God. It's powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces even to the dividing asunder, soul and spirit. Let it go deep into our lives this morning is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Did you know the Bible has more to say about the horrors of hell than the splendors of heaven? The Bible has, it doesn't want us to go there. It has more to say about the horrors of hell than the splendors of heaven. I love what one preacher did. He said, he told the congregation that the next week he was going to try to describe hell to them. He was going to try to describe what it was like. And so during the week, he asked the secretary of the church. They had a marquee, a board out front that you could change the wording on. And they would always put the sermon title, and they would put an announcement from the church or an event that's taking place at the church underneath the sermon title. And so she went out and she put the sermon title that he was going to preach on. But she forgot to remove the other thing that it said. The other thing, and what it said is, come here, our Easter choir. And so she put the new title of the sermon up above that, which said, what is hell like? And she forgot to take the bottom part out. And so the marquee at the church read, what is hell like? Come here, our Easter choir. Well, we're blessed with it. We got a wonderful choir. We're very blessed in our choir. Well, I want to give you some points about heaven. Number one, and this is very basic, and you understand this, that heaven's just going to be a wonder-filled place. Wonderful and wonder-filled. Now, I got to begin by saying this when I talk about heaven. I certainly don't know all there is to know about heaven. Sometimes we read the Bible and we go, we don't have a clue. We read the Bible, something new, we try to understand it, we say, wow, that's amazing. Matter of fact, the Bible says in Corinthians that our eyes have not seen, our ears have not heard, it has not entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those that love him. That's amazing right there. That's enough to be thankful for right there. The Bible says that we see through a glass darkly, and then face to face. We just see darkly. We don't see at all. But one day we'll see face to face. Here's what I know about heaven. Here's what I believe. It won't be boring. Heaven will not be boring. I remember when I first got saved as a 16-year-old, and I'd go to church, and preachers would say things about, we're going to wear that heavenly robe, and we're going to sing in that heavenly choir. And I'm just a young man. I don't understand all that. I think, well, when we get to heaven, we're just going to be in a big multi-million member choir. I just didn't want to go to hell. Now, the choir thing did not intrigue me. I'll be honest with you. I thought, and I didn't say this, and at the time I wouldn't have said that, but I don't want to sing in a choir for eternity. Amen. You know? Okay, thank you very much. And you know, you're either saying you don't want me to sing in the choir for eternity. Is that what you're saying? Okay. Yeah, I'm going, there's more to it. Matter of fact, Meyer doesn't want me to sing in the choir here. I said, Meyer, I think I can help you. She said, no, you can't. I've heard you sing. How many of you are like me? You say, Pastor, I'm just not a good singer. Yeah, yes, you're right, amen. I've heard some of you. Yes, amen. And Pat Locker's not here today. He's in Georgia, went to a wedding. We would say, Pat, you don't need to join the choir. How many of you say, Pastor, I can carry a tune. I can carry a tune pretty good. Raise your hand. Yeah, you sing pretty, you are so humble, good. Meyer, there's choir prospects right there. I just got them for you. Just a few. Meyer said, Bill, you sing baritone when you sing. I said, well, thank you very much. She said, no, people can't bear the tone when you sing. I said, well, we're doing the best we can. I used to pray. Lord, I want to sing so badly. And he answered that prayer. I sing so badly now. So listen, the heavenly choir, it didn't motivate me. I just didn't want to go to hell. And so I said, okay, I'll just sing in that choir. And then I began to realize there's much more to heaven than the heavenly choir. Now, you may be here and you say, I can't wait to sing in that choir. Good. Good, I hope they put you right out there, right in front of the choir. But there's some other things. But I don't think it's like this lady also. This lady, she said this about heaven. This was her epitaph. From the 1860s, here's what she wrote. It read, her epitaph read, here lies a poor woman who was always tired, for she lived in a place where help was not hired. Her last words on earth were, dear friends, I am going, where washing ain't done, nor sweeping or sewing. And everything there is exact to my wishes. For there they don't eat, and there's no washing of dishes. Don't weep for me now, don't weep for me never. I'm going to do nothing forever and ever. Huh? That's not biblical. She had the wrong idea of heaven. That's terrible theology. Heaven's a wonderful place, full of wonder. Nothing here on earth compares to it. Mark Twain was an atheist. He said he preferred hell over heaven. He said, heaven may have a better climate. Hell may have, he said, heaven may have a better climate than hell. He said, but hell has better company. I said, oh me, that's not right, is it? He's never been face to face with a demon, has he? Let me tell you something wonderful about heaven on the screen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51 through 53. It says, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. We'll all have a new body. We'll all be changed. This fleshly will put on a spiritual. This earthly will put on eternal. This mortal will put on an immortal body. We shall all be changed one day. This flesh cannot inherit the heavenly. He says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. Somebody said that trumpet's going to toot and I'm going to scoot. It's going to happen. And we shall be changed. Verse 53. There it is. For this corruptible must put on an incorruption to go to heaven. This mortal must put on an immortality. Understand, one of the things that's going to take place, you will get a glorified body. Now that would have been a great place for some of you to say amen. because your body right now is pretty rough. You're struggling a little bit. You remember when last week we went to the tomb there and we described what was happening to the tomb, and we were over here at the tomb and Mary turned to the gardener. She thought it was the gardener and said, if you tell me where they've left him, I'll go get the body. And Jesus said, Mary. And she realized it was Jesus there in the book of John. And she reached out. He said, touch me not, for I have not ascended to the Father. And he hasn't received his glorified body yet. So he went to the Father, and remember that evening he shows up. He shows up into the room, and he can touch him while he'd receive his glorified body. That's the body we'll have in heaven, the glorified body, a new body, a wonderful body, a perfect body. Now, next time you see that loved one, they'll look new. They'll look new, healthy, excited. That new body. That glory, that perfect body. Now, I know you're thinking. You're thinking, Pastor, don't you already have a perfect body? You're not thinking that, are you? Years ago, Years ago, when Meyer and I first got married, some of you heard the story. We hadn't been married long, but we were at the parsonage there, and I got my shower that morning, wrapped my towel around me. Myra was still in bed, and I walked around her, and I went, flexed my muscles in front of her. Flexed those muscles, and she put on her best Sally Struthers voice. She said, just think, for 35 cents a day, the price of a cup of coffee, you can support a starving child. I sort of deflated right there and then. It scarred me. I've never forgotten it. But you and I in heaven, one day we'll have that perfect body, that glorified body. And I'm telling you what, there's perfect beauty in heaven. It's hard to describe heaven. There's nothing boring about heaven. There's nothing bland about heaven. It's beyond description. On the screen, Revelation chapter 21, verse 18 through 21. Look what it says. The walls was jasper, the color of glory. The city was pure gold, translucent as glass. You imagine looking at it. It's hard to imagine, isn't it? It's hard to put in our mind. The foundation of the city walls were garnished with every precious gem imaginable. The first foundation, jasper. And jasper can be multicolored. It says the first foundation, jasper. The second was sapphire. Sapphire is a beautiful blue stone. It says, the third, a gate. That's a transparent stone. The fourth is an emerald. That's a greenish stone. Next verse. The fifth, onyx. That's a bluish, whitish, red, and red stone. Then carnelian. That's a blood red stone. And then the seventh is crystallite. It's a goldish stone. And then there's beryl. That's a transparent bluish green. And then there's topaz. That's a pale green, a mixture of yellow. Then there's Christopressus, whatever that word is, it's a stone. It's a yellowish green with tint of blue. There's a jacinth. It's red with a mixture of yellow. There's amethyst. It's purple or violet. And then it says the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each gate a single pearl. Huge gates made of, God made pearls. And there's not just one street. There's many streets. Why do you say that? Why do I read that? Because it's elegant. Heaven's elegant. It's made up of jewels and precious stones, beautiful, brilliant colors. Meyer and I, a few years back, went to Israel. It was one of the greatest experiences of our lives. Matter of fact, our denomination is there this week. Every year they take a trip there. They're there this week. Matter of fact, the pastor at Piedmont, Charles Thomas is over there, and the pastor at Young's Chapel out there in Hoax Bluff, Bruce Jenkins, I'm telling you what, is there. About 30 of our pastors are there this week. There, Israel is being covered over with some Southern boys, good old Southern boys this week, going around talking some redneck talk. Israel may never be the same. You pray for the land of Israel. Meyer and I saw, we prayed at the Wailing Wall. You take a piece of paper. You take a piece and you write people's names, or you write prayer requests, and you put it in the cracks on those walls, and you pray for them. Some of your names, when I was there, I put on a piece of paper and I put in that wall, the deacons, the staff, I put in that wall there, and I prayed. We floated in the Dead Sea. We stood on top of Mount Masada. We went to Calvary in the Garden Tomb. Myra sang in the Garden Tomb area, and we received communion together. We rode a camel. We were, both of us were baptized in the Jordan, and I helped baptize 35 others. Myra sang on the Sea of Galilee. We saw things we had never seen before. We ate foods we had never eaten before. We had adventures. Every day was amazing. And then we went back every evening to a 5-star hotel. My point, if it was that good there, how good is it going to be there? It will be an adventure. It will be an experience. Can you imagine seeing all of God's creation? Now, one preacher said this. This is what I said, wow, I've never heard that before. One preacher believes this. He says he believes that God will let us explore the universe. I never thought that before. I'm going, does he mean that we get to like explore the universe and go see Saturn up close? Do we get to go to the planets anywhere in the universe? I don't know. I don't know. But that's what one preacher had written. He said, we get to explore the universe. I'm not sure how it works, but I know this. It's not going to be boring. It's not going to be bland. It's going to be beautiful for us. Heaven will be wonderful, far above and beyond anything you can hope or imagine. Number two, heaven's not a worldly place. It's not a worldly place. It's different than here. Look what's going to happen. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There's no more death. Praise the Lord. There's no more sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. It's the no mores. It's the no mores about everything is new. He said, there's no more sickness. There's no more sorrow. There's no more suffering in heaven. There's no more pain. There's no more problems. There's no more disease in heaven. There's no more Alzheimer's. There's no more cancer. There's no more diabetes. There's no more losses. There's no more confusion or confinement. There's no more loneliness for people that they struggle with that. There's no more heartache for people. There's no blindness, no lameness, no brokenness, no broken bodies. No hurts, no harm, no hate, no persecution. There's no wars. There's no worry of ISIS in heaven. There's no rust, rot, or rats in heaven. There's no debt or death in heaven. There's no hopelessness, terrorism, starvation. There's no depression. There's no emotional struggles. There's no mental illness. And there's something else not in heaven. There's no more demons. There's no more wickedness in heaven. On the screen, Revelation 21, verse 7 and 8. He that overcomes shall inherit all things. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake, which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. On the screen, Revelation 21, verse 27. The 12 gates, and every several gate was of pearl. The street was city of pure gold. It was transparent glass. It will be beautiful. Wicked people will not experience that. Only millions of Christians will be there, glorified bodies in a beautiful heavenly home. Heaven's a wonderful place. It's not a worldly place. And number three, heaven's got a wonderful person. Amen. Just looking forward to seeing the Lord. Jesus, and the city had no need of the sun, neither the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. He is worthy. He paid the price for you to go to heaven. You ever thought, what will you do when you see Jesus? You ever thought, when you stand before him, or kneel before him, or sit before him, or bow before him? I know there's a lot of criers in this church, part of the Kleenex committee here, which I am one. Maybe you will just cry. I really, you know, sometimes in worship and sometimes in prayer, you think about what you do when you see Jesus. The reality is we're not worthy to look upon his face. The reality is we feel like John the Baptist. I'm not worthy to tie shoes or sandals. Just think if to look up is such a humbling thought. But Jesus is there, and he's prepared a place for us. And I don't want you to miss it. I don't want one of you to miss heaven. It's coming. It's going to take place. It's going to be on its way. Jesus is coming again. It'll take place. Let me close with a story. Dr. Criswell said this. Dr. Criswell was this gentleman passed away, I think 2002. He pastored First Baptist of Dallas for 55 years. Unbelievable. At the time, it was the largest church, may still be. Matter of fact, Barry, we met the pastor at Randy Jeffries, First Baptist. We met and had pictures made with him and talked to him at a general conference. Dr. W.A. Criswell, he tells his story that he got on a plane. He got on a plane and sat down. He didn't know the gentleman he was sitting next to, and he asked him, introduced himself. And the guy said that he was a biblical scholar. And Dr. Criswell told him who he was, and they hit it off immediately. And the biblical scholar said, let me tell you a story. He said there was a 9-year-old little boy came home from school one day with a fever. And the parents just thought it was a 24-hour thing that would pass. And they made him comfortable and got him in bed. And then he didn't get better. So they knew that there was something else going on. And then they took him to the doctor, which then to the hospital, and he had meningitis. And the doctor said there's nothing else we could do, and he's not going to make it. And so the family was just floored. And they did everything they could to make him comfortable, and the days passed, and he continued to get worse. And the gentleman sitting next to Dr. Criswell is telling the story, and he said, so one day it was beautiful outside, and that little boy had woke up, and he said, Daddy, it's dark outside, isn't it? It's getting dark outside, isn't it? And the dad said, yes, it is, son, it's getting dark. But it wasn't getting dark, it was a little boy. And he turned over and tucked him in a little more and fluffed his pillow up. And he said, Daddy, I'm getting tired. He said, I'm getting tired now, Daddy. I'm going to go to sleep. And dad said, that's fine, son. You just go to sleep. And then the little boy said, good night, Daddy. I'll see you in the morning. And with that, the little boy closed his eyes and he stepped over into eternity and into heaven. Dr. Criswell said in that story, he said that biblical scholar turned his head and looked out the plane window for a long time. And then he turned back to Dr. Criswell and said with tears in his eyes, Mr. Criswell, I can hardly wait till morning. Because it was his son. The message from the Bible, the message from Jesus, there's a morning coming. There's a morning coming when the dead in Christ will rise. There's a morning coming when there'll be no more crying or tears or sorrow or death or pain. There's a morning coming when the wrongs of this world will be set right. There's a morning coming that many of us can hardly wait for. There's a morning coming with heaven on the other side. But you just don't go to heaven by being good or trying hard. You go to heaven because Jesus Christ paid the price and you've accepted him into your heart and life. He's your Savior. That's the book. You go to heaven because Jesus Christ lives in your heart. John 3:3, you must be born again. John 14:6, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm going to ask Stephen to come at this time to sing the invitation for us. You can be seated. Do you know him as Savior? Are you on your way to heaven? Here's what I want us to do while Stephen's singing. While Stephen's singing, if you need to give your heart and life to Christ, you come to this altar. We'll pray with you. While he's singing, if you need to rededicate your life to Christ, pray, make sure of things, we'll pray with you. If you want to pray for family members who need Christ, you come and pray. If you want to pray for the families that have lost loved ones, you come and pray. We'll have a season of prayer here while Steve sings for us. You remain seated, then come to the altar as you like. Steve.
can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees or will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart be?
Yes, let's stand. Stand with me. Let's worship the Lord.
Oh, all of you be still.
Thank the Lord. Just worship Him.
To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine.
Take your time at the altar. You take your time. Tell them you love them. Tell them you love them. Others, you be seated and comfortable. And God bless you. We love you.